Everyone, my name is Surya, and my colleague Aslam.
Hello, everyone.
Today, before we start the presentation, let me just ask you guys a few questions. First, how many of you guys here are developers? Put up your hand. Okay. How many of you guys feel that right now what you're doing, you're taking too long before you know you make any small change and make its way into production? Okay. And how many of you guys feel that right now you can be more productive if you don't have to deal with a lot of team conflicts or merge conflicts and all those things? Okay, cool. So it means that I'm in the right room and you guys are the same. So today we are going to talk about not the perfect, we are not going to define what is a perfect CI/CD process, but instead what we are going to share today is the lessons that we have learned when we built the CI/CD pipeline at Redmart. That is right now supporting the high velocity software development pipeline that we have in Redmart. Okay, so rather than talking about theories and best practices, today we are going to show you instead a demo of what it takes. Let's say you start from an idea. How does it flow throughout the pipeline and all the way to the production, and you see it live? So we have been scratching our head the past few days to think about what kind of things we could put up for the demo so that we can show it is really making its way from the beginning right all the way to the production without breaking anything. Okay, so this is just a simple hypothetical story that we've created. Let's say, for whatever purpose, we find that the greeting login that you see here, when you log in to the redmart.com, we want to do something about it. We want to change that information. So right now, what you get when you log in is the email ID that you use for logging in, right? So the estimated time, let's say, for this story is 1 hour. And what you're going to see today is the three workflow, three parts of the pipeline, which is the feature development stage, and then how it actually goes into the pre-production stage and all the way to live in production. So I'm going to show you right now what is going to happen. So due to the time constraint, there are certain steps that we have skipped, but I'm going to explain what those steps are at a later part of the presentations. So we have created this feature branch for today's demo. So what I'm going to show you is that this feature environment is now live for this feature test environment, and we're going to see that right now, as you can see, this is still showing me the email ID that I used to log in, right? And what we're going to do next is to make sure that we are on the right branch here. And next step is we'll make the changes. Okay. It's on this line that we're gonna insert this simple logic. Okay, and one important part that gets people freaked out usually is how do I test any change that I make, right? So here today we are gonna show you how that unit testing is done for the feature that we are implementing. Okay. So we are done with all the changes that we need. Now let's push that. Okay. Okay. Yep, it's right now going into GitHub, where it triggers the CI/CD pipeline. While the build is happening, we're gonna move on, and then we'll come back at to look at what exactly happens there. So just to give you a key summary of the tech organizations in Redmart, what does it look like currently? So first is that we have 80 plus engineering team that is spread across two geographical locations in Singapore and Bangalore. What is interesting is that out of these 80 plus engineers, they are split into 20 plus autonomous teams. One of the key challenge that we face when we are scaling up, and I'm sure that any organizations will face when they are going through that scaling up phase, is that out of these 20 plus teams, they are not formed all at once, right? So they are slowly, you know, being added and all that. So one of the key issue there is different teams will be at a different maturity level, whether it is in terms of the team cohesion itself, whether it is the knowledge that they have about the whole infrastructure and all that. So when designing a CI/CD pipeline, that is, I think, one of the most important thing that we have to pay attention to, because we cannot assume that all teams will be able to pick up, you know, whatever we have immediately, right? And out of these 20 plus teams, they are working on 100 plus microservices that we have right now. And each of these team is actually able to move at the speed that is they're comfortable with, without, you know, getting blocked by every other team. Because we do not want that having more teams actually bring down the productivity instead of increasing the productivity. And then some of the other things is we have four deploy environments to manage in. So the first one is the feature environment. That is where, you know, all the feature development, testings, and all that are happening. And then we have the pre-production setup. And then what happens in pre-production is actually we have the exact mirror of what is in production. And then we have additional environment called beta. We don't use it often. We usually reserve it for bigger features. And then we have the production environment itself. And then out of this, 100 microservices, they are mostly largely based in Java, Scala, and there are other languages as well, like Node.js, Angular, Python, and even Go. So the key there is really how you design the CI/CD pipeline that takes care of all these heterogeneous languages that we have. And right now, we have about 20 to 30 rollouts happening every day. Okay. So some of the key ingredients that we have in the pipeline is, first, I think it's most of you would have been on board, which is GitHub workflow itself. So instead of maintaining many branches, we keep a single master branch. And then we have multiple feature branches. And then we have the second part of the pipeline is the continuous integrations. That is where, just now, if you saw the code that I demonstrated, For every feature that you implement, you know, you have the corresponding unit testing that comes with it. And we have the code coverage analysis and all that. The third part of that pipeline is the continuous delivery. So what happens in this stage is where the artifacts are getting built and they are properly versioned according to the standard semantic versioning. And then once these artifacts is generated, they get uploaded to the S3 buckets, the corresponding S3 buckets. And the last part of this pipeline is actually the continuous deployment, okay? When we talk about continuous deployment, it can vary across different organizations. So here, in our definition, I'm not saying this is the right or the wrong definitions, but how do we define continuous deployment? Is that any code change that you make, it gets deployed to the right environment immediately. And you can even take it all the way, like a simple code change, and push it to production directly. There's nothing stopping that. Usually, comes in between is the business side of things, right? So usually you don't want to push things into production before the rest of the organizations is ready with those new features that you are implementing. So once the business user say, okay, I'm ready to go with it, you know, technically you can just say, I want to deploy that feature into production immediately. Okay. So let's see what happens now with the build. I'm not sure if the build just now has actually completed. It looks like it is still running. So during this process, actually, as you can see here, it is actually running a lot of tests before even it gets to the point where it can generate, you know, it can generate the artifacts itself. It looks like there has been some delay in the build. Okay, so this build usually takes about 15 minutes to complete. So in the meantime, we can just move on, and then we'll take a look back at what happens there. Okay, so this is how a typical software development lifecycle happens in Redmart. So it all started with a developer working on the local machine. And they do the code changes and everything in the local machine, right? So what is unique in Redmart infrastructure that we have is developers, when they are testing locally, they have two options. One is to tap on whatever infrastructure that we have. So without any additional configuration or whatever, when they run the test on their local machine, it can be just one service that they are testing, but the rest of the resources, they are reusing whatever is already there in the rest of the infrastructure. The second option is actually, they can do a mock on all the resources, like let's say the database, we're using Mongo, and the cache and the messaging queue. So once they feel that, I'm done with some of these changes and then I wanna push the code. So what happens here is it will trigger the CI/CD process that runs all these tests that you see just now running in Travis itself. If something breaks, it will go back to the developer and then they will fix it. But if the whole CI/CD process is completed successfully, it will automatically get deployed into the feature environment. So one of the things here that is noteworthy is that you know, instead of developers, developing and testing the changes locally, as early as this stage, they can involve the rest of the teams, like QA and even the end user, which is the business user in most cases. And then, and also one important thing is that we want to give developers the feeling, the comfortable feeling that, you know, whatever change that they are making, they don't have to worry that it's going to break anything. Okay, and they know that it's going to get deployed into a production-like environment without worrying that, you know, somebody is going to come after them and say, you know, screaming at them and for breaking something, right? So that is what our feature environment is created for. They can feel free to commit changes and, you know, break things there. And this is the usual loop. That's why it's thicker there. So as early as this stage, developers can get feedback from the real user itself. And it goes back until, you know, the QA and the end user, the stakeholders say, okay, I'm good with those feature changes. Now we are ready to go into production. So the next stage will be, you know, they go into the pre-production environment. This is really a close mirror of what is production. And once they say that, okay, I have tested everything here and you are ready to push this feature to go live. So all that can happen with just a simple script. Let's see, the build doesn't seem... Okay, so looks like it is still taking a bit more time. So maybe I'll pause at this stage. Do you guys have any questions? Maybe. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question about your deployment. So you mentioned the artifacts go into repository in S3, and then how do you discover these new artifacts to deploy them?
Okay. So that is actually covered in the later part of the slides of the presentations. But just to give that brief answer is that there is locations in our artifacts repository that is dedicated for that feature. Yeah.
So can you explain how the feature environment works? Do you have multiple feature environments just for one feature? How many boxes or?
So the interesting thing about our feature environment setup, which I think is going to be covered soon as well, is that it is just a small delta of what we have in the pre-production environment. But to the real users, they are really seeing as if there are that many feature sites that is live. And the number of instances in the feature environment really depends on how big those features are. It can be just like one instance for if, let's say, that feature touches only one service, or it can be multiple. It depends on. So okay. So I think it's time for that. So just now you guys see that, okay, even here it is showing my email ID, right? Sorry, I'm not Daniel, but yeah, it was showing Daniel. So what you're gonna see next is that, yep, so instead of picking that email ID, remember the code change that we did. So we are just adding these few lines of code to say that if that is the, I mean, we, for this purpose, we just want to constrain to make sure that it only happens for this user. And we set the first name as Jack Demo. So at this point, we have seen that how it is actually getting deployed in this feature environment without any intervention from the developers. And, oh no, something is, okay. So yeah, going back to that feature environment and all that. So this is how the deployment environment looks like. So as you can see here on the leftmost is actually our feature environment. It to the real user or rather to the stakeholders themselves, they see that, you know, if you have n number of features, as if there are n numbers of sites. But in actual case, there is only a single site where it is the pre-production environment. So what we have created is a delta for each feature. So let's say feature A, it touches like two services. Feature B, it touches another two or three services. So those are the delta that we call in this feature environment. So the trick there is really to create the feature routing that is smart enough to tell that, hey, you know, for this feature, for this service, I'm supposed to go into where, whether it is the feature instance or is it the pre-production instances, right? And the same concept we have extended and applied to the beta environment and the production environment. So as I mentioned earlier, for beta, we really reserve it for critical features. So for example, like changing the payment gateway. And let's say we need to support Alipay. And the other example is like, let's say we need to change the entire flow of how an order is created. Right? How does it make its way from the front end when somebody places the order all the way to the back end until it touches our you know, finances and all that. So those kind of features usually are what we put under the beta sites where we usually let the internal users, Red Martians themselves, have a go at it, place real order there. So as you can see, the difference between beta and the pre-production is that the data in pre-production is just test data. What happens in beta is it is real data, okay, that it's sharing with the production environment. So again, this beta environment, we are just creating a delta. So let's say for that case, you know, for payment service, you need to change the way the payment is handled. You know, it probably touches a few services like checkout service and payment service. So we just have that delta in here and it is sharing the real production data with what is there in the production. Okay. Now that we have so far, just now what we have seen is that okay, sorry, it seems that we have reached only this stage of the workflow. So what we have seen just now from the demo is that it gets deployed in the feature, right? And now the next question is, how do we level it up to the pre-production environment, right? Just now we mentioned that after testing is all good, how do we go into that pre-production environment? So I'm going to show you how that happens. So this is done. So we'll just go to the repository. And what we do is we just need to create a PR. Okay. So the common practice here is that okay, create a pull request. Here, I'm not assigning this PR to anyone, but usually the common practice that we have is for any code change that is to be merged into master, it has to go through this pull request and at least one or two engineers have to review those changes before allowing those changes to be merged into the master branch. Okay, so with that, actually, this is just a PR, right? So the next is After the other engineers actually reviewed those changes, what they have to do is to merge the pull requests. Usually the same engineers who does the PR, they are not allowed to merge. But for this demo purpose, let's just merge this thing. Okay. With that, you know, that sets its way into the pre-production environment. Because once you merge it and it gets pushed into the master branch, immediately it actually gets deployed into the pre-production environment, which is what is shown here in blue. Okay, so just to recap a bit, for this normal situation is that you don't have this beta routing in between. So all the way from here, it makes its way to the production environment. So while you know, waiting for the build to happen, we have actually prepared a bonus feature. So here is another story. Aslam will explain more about that.
So guys, this, because the demo which you just now, Surya, explained, that is actually demonstrating our backend service, like how we are pushing the changes to the backend service. So we thought it will be good if you can demonstrate for the front end also. So this demo is just targeting the front end service. So in our Redmart website, we have this need help option. And in that, we have this FAQ. So our development team decided that this FAQ is no more required. They already covered this inside this help. So with this demo, what we are going to present is we are going to push this change, and it will be reflected in our Redmart website immediately. So the estimated effort is actually 0.5, which is mentioned here. And since you guys already gone through this feature workflow and pre-production workflow, which already Surya explained, so I feel like it's to directly goes to production. So before going to production, I would like to give some okay, so yeah. So before actually going to production, I feel like, okay, let me just show you like how we, because this feature is already tested in our feature environment and pre-production environment. So I'll just demonstrate like, okay, if I just go to that feature environment, which actually we call the same jug demo. So this is our feature environment, and in that, you can see this option is not having that FAQ right now. And because this is already propagated to our pre-production environment, so if I just go to alpha.redmart.com, that option is not available here. So now I'm going to promote this feature to production. Yeah, okay, I would like to invite you guys if you just go to the redmart.com and this option you will see. So if I just go here also to in this, you can see this FAQ option is there. So I'm going to make a production release. Don't worry, should be fine. So in the way we actually push releases to production is actually just single point of entry, which is actually calling one script. So this is the script which we have actually configured. And this script is actually just to make sure that every team members should follow the same convention whenever they want to push anything to production. And this is common applicable to all the services. So for this, I just, and apart, and with this, because we are following the semantic versioning also, so we have to specify what, for example, if I just run this script without any argument, it can specify like whether you want to bump up which version type, whether it's a minor, major, or patch. Based on that, it will automatically manage the version. So I'm just bumping the patch. So it is expecting a short summary, like what's the purpose of this release, so you can specify that. So here I'm just going to removing the FAQ option from need help. Drop down menu. So once you push, then this will automatically do a commit into the service, which is our golden grocer service, and then it triggers the CI/CD pipeline. So if I just go to our Travis, I can see the build is triggered. So it will take a bit time to push the changes to production. So in the meantime, I can continue.
I haven't sure trigger for that one. You have.
Trigger for, sorry?
Yeah, for this one. Let me just show.
Oh, okay, you want to show that?
Yeah, so.
Okay.
Can you get the volume up? Oh, sorry.
Because I think you also want to trigger the release so that in the meantime.
Because earlier, remember, for the member service, the backend service that we have merged to master, right? By right, we should wait until it gets deployed into the pre-production stage and before we do the same, like what Aslam did for the front-end service. So, but to cut short, because I don't think we're going to have time if we wait further, so we'll skip that verification. I mean, we'll skip that certification from the QA and all that. We just say that, okay, but I'm still going to show you how it happens in alpha.redmart.com. But now we'll just do a trigger to production for that member service and praise that nothing breaks. Okay, so I have to first switch branch to master. Okay, I'm on a master branch now. And what I have to do is I have to do a git pull. Remember that we have just merged from that feature branch into the master branch. We'll do a git pull. Okay, so we have the changes that we have pushed earlier. So what we're gonna do next is just trigger prod release patch. Okay. Jack demo in action. Okay, that's it. And with that, actually, you let go of the hook and let it go all the way to the production, which we're gonna take a look at it later on.
So let me see how it's still going on. Okay, so I think in the meantime, okay, so in the meantime, I'll continue for the slide. Okay, here it looks our CI/CD pipeline, what we are following in Redmart. And I think you already saw what we did. The same, the main components which we have, if you see, like the same Travis for this continuous integration and deployments. and AWS for bucket, S3 bucket and storage of the build artifact. We are using Chef to get that, identify the specific nodes for getting the deployments to be triggered. And we have Nexus also for sharing library resources which are dependent across the different services. And we are using SonarQube for code quality check and publishing whatever the results during the builds to the dashboard. A part of this, one of the things which we are actually using is this version manager. This is the, I think this is the place where the guy asked question is the one who is actually responsible for doing all the manipulations of the version, like how the version will be automatically bumped and based on that trigger which we passed from the script. So we, the same, like we are following semantic versioning, so that's why we have this major, minor, and patch, and based on that trigger, it is updating that particular one. The artifact is getting generated, and that artifact is pushed to our S3. Because we are having different buckets for different environments, so because of that, the version is properly updated, and artifact is actually going into the respective bucket. Since we did the production release, so the generated artifact will goes into the release bucket. If it is for this pre-production, it is going into this master bucket, and if it is for beta environment, it is going into the beta, and similarly for the feature. This is how the things is getting done. And because this Chef, it is because our infrastructure is automated using this one, so it is actually getting all the list of nodes in which it is needs to be deployed. So let me see how the build is. So it's still going on. So I think we are close to finish. Okay. As I explained, for example, this is what we just now mentioned. Like for this member service, which Surya already pushed, we have, this is in the S3. So we have the same like beta feature and master and release. And in that, if you can see, we have this artifact with this merge versioning, with the semantic versioning. So here you can see like this artifact is meant for only master, which is pre-production, because this artifact is having pre-releases. So our convention is like any pre-releases will always get deployed in pre-production environment. But if the artifact is having just like major, minor, and patch version, then it's get deployed into the production environment. So the CI/CD pipeline automatically identifies for which artifact and for which environment we have to trigger the deployment. So I think by now the release is done. Let me refresh the screen. Yeah, so release is done. So let me just go to, I think you guys can also try, go to the redmart.com. And if you go to this need help, so that option is gone. Okay, so this is one of the feature which was planned for today's rollout. So this is how we did actually. So we thought let's make this as part of our demo. And So this is how when the build, this is just one of the sample, like how we are publishing the code quality status to our SonarQube. So you can see just like a sample service which we have, like inbound service for that we have generated. So you can see the coverage details also along with ratings and the issues and those kind of things. So using this, the developers will just analyze and go to that and then do their fixing. Sorry, yes. Okay. So here I'm going to show you like what we did. I think you already saw that, how we trigger a production. So when we plan for any production release in Redmart, we have this script, which is meant for this purpose. And in this script, we specify two things, which is one is the release type, and the second is the deploy region. But generally, because right now it is only for the Singapore, So our services and everything is deployed here. So that's why by default we just take this option as SG. Otherwise, if our services are getting deployed into a different region, we can actually trigger the same release gone into both regions at the same time. So that option is actually for internationalization, which we have that capability. And as soon as we plan to deploy in different geographies, we can actually move on. But the functionality is available with us. Okay, so when the release is happened, after that we are doing some notifications and updates also. Like how to notify, like, okay, the release is done, but some mechanism needs to be in place so that people know that, okay, some release has happened and who did that release, those kind of things. So one is actually the email alerts, in which this is just one of the sample. So in this, it is mentioned that, okay, just one release has happened with this version, whatever the version is released, and whatever commit messages or commit history is there, as well as the summary what we have typed. So this is just one of the sample. I think if we can get email, I can demonstrate that also what we did for this golden grocer just now. We have a Slack channel also. So any production release is getting updated here also. So that, and it's having all the references. So this reference is for the Travis build, there's a summary, and this is the version and actual the author who did that release. So these kind of things is updated in the Slack channel also. And the last one is update in the GitHub. So when we do the tagging as part of the release, we are actually generating the summary also in that. And the same thing, what we are actually getting in the email, the same thing is here also. So it's like all the places we are getting updated. Okay, so I think that's the demo part for that production release for the front-end service. I think let's Surya to continue. Okay.
Yeah, usually Travis doesn't take this long to actually complete the build. I don't know what happened today. It seems to take a little bit longer than usual. But anyway, going back to where we left off. Where we left off just now was we didn't even go that stage yet. We wanted to see how that features actually happens in the pre-production stage of the pipeline, right? So it means that it is the same alpha environment that Aslam was showing just now. So that new feature is gonna kick in after I log out and I log in again. Okay, so as you can see here, did you guys see that it is no longer showing the email ID, but instead it is showing the message that we modified. Okay, I think it's gonna take a few more minutes for the build to complete. While, you know, waiting for that to happen, maybe I can take one short question. Yeah.
I was wondering, let's say you have a feature involving both your front-end and back-end. How do you manage the merging and push to production?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very interesting question, and that is one problem that we end up facing a lot of time. You know, in Redmart, what you see in redmart.com is just, you know, the consumer-facing apps. Right, but actually to power the entire e-commerce business, what happens is we need to have a lot of internal services, internal apps rather, to support all this, right? How do we manage the customer feedback, order problems and all that? Customer service will have to have the proper dashboards and all that to look at those things. So that is where we face a lot of problems usually, because it means that they have to coordinate between front end as well as back end. To us, it is we feel that we could add all the automation that we want, but the key there is, you know, the coordination among the team members, because there is no level of automation that can guarantee that when somebody is pushing something at the back end, that is going to be breaking and the front end is not ready, right? And there is just to us, at least until this point, maybe we will be proven wrong at some point, but to us at this point, we still see that as, you know, as the key solution. So the proper coordination has to be done between the front end guys and the back end. Yep. Okay. Has the build? Okay. 2 more minutes.
Yeah. Hi. How do you manage to revert to the leaf if you have to?
Okay. That itself, right now, we have the scripts as well, so that trigger prod release is able to deploy a specific version that you want. So you have in the buckets all the artifacts, they are not going to get overwritten, they're still going to stay there. So you just specify which versions you want to redeploy and it gets deployed.
Do you always follow the same flow even in some kind of emergency situation? Like some errors or some sort of environment, then also you always follow the same flow or you have some other flow?
No, for those, I would say like hot fixes are exceptions. It depends on the severity again, but hot fixes, correct me if I'm wrong, Alejandro. Do you want to add something on that?
We might skip the feature environment.
Yeah, hot fixes, we directly actually try to go to the master. Like PR directly merge to the master, and then the hot fix is verified into that and then get deployed.
Yeah, so for those cases, we make the exceptions because, like I said, all the facilities is there, even if they want to release to production at this point of time, any change. It's just that usually they don't follow unless I mean, usually they will follow the normal process unless it's critical fixes like that. Yeah? Yeah?
Is it possible to share the script?
Sorry?
Share the script.
The script?
Yeah.
We are working to open source that. We'd love to. Yeah, when we are ready, we'll open source it. Okay.
It's basically just a shell script that creates a Git commit of some sort, right?
Yeah, that's one thing, but as Aslam mentioned, it's also about semantic versioning, right? So it takes care of that, and also environments where you're deploying it to, all those things are done over there.
Yeah. It's all good?
Not yet.
Not yet. Yeah.
Huge build pipeline.
When you are actually deploying to production, what you're doing is creating a new stack of production, or?
Interesting. Right now, I would say that we are not at the ideal level or ideal place that we want, which we are working on right now, which is to introduce the canary releases. Right now, we do not have that. So we deploy on each instance one by one and currently. Yep.
How do you release an artifact like a group? When you build the push into production, you get the artifact from the team production and push into production, or you build it again and push into production?
So it builds again. Remember, that's not that PR. After that, you merge, right? And then when we trigger that script, what happens is that it pushes a commit with the empty message, with just a pre-formatted comments on it. And then Travis will trigger the build, and then we'll pick up based on the comments whether it is supposed to be a production release or not. So there is a certain format.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Is it ready?
Yep.
Not yet. So, any more questions?
For the artifacts which are putting into the S3 buckets, are you using the S3 versioning? Is that what you mean? Or just the artifact versioning that you do for your
It's artifact versioning.
So nothing
Nope. Yeah. Right now, I mean, there is this slim probability that will happen, because we when we do that update, we don't switch off traffic to those instances, right? For critical ones, yes, we do. Like, especially those related to payments and all that, we make sure that we stop traffic to that those instances before, you know, we deploy it. Yeah, but like I said, ideally we wanna have all this. But in fact, we do have.
Like for the front end services, just now what you what we demoed actually, in that what the same process we do, we actually remove the instance from the ELB so that no traffic will come to that instance and then trigger the deployment. And then once the deployment is done, then we attach it back and then remove the other one, like that we do for the front-end services.
So yeah, we have that for the, our internal app service that we detach it from ELB, so stop traffic entirely, and then we do the deployment. Once the deployment finish on that nodes, and then we will attach that node back into the ELB, turn traffic back on, and then detach the other instance, and then those are done automatically. Yeah. All good?
Yeah.
So I'll come back to your questions in a bit. So right now, you have seen that in redmart.com, in Alpha, it was working fine. So what I'm going to show you now is in the production site, okay? So hopefully nothing breaks. Yeah, so you see now the change is happening in production itself. Right. Okay.
You just deface it.
Yeah, I could have applied it to everyone else, but I may get fired after that. Okay, so what you have seen today is, you know, we have taken you guys from one example where we have a simple idea on a story that we want to work on, how we propagate that story all the way, you know, to the proper test environment for it to get tested and, you know, certified with all the stakeholders. And how we allow developers to make that call that, you know, now I'm ready to deploy my things into production. Like I said, the definition of continuous deployment vary from organization to organizations. And in our case, if you can see, for the front-end services, like just now what Aslam was demonstrating, the rollout can happen like 10, 20 times a day, right? Because it is just a shell, or rather, you know, just a static pages and all that, without disrupting the business functionality. But for most other services or most other features that touches, you know, the core business operation itself, which I think a lot of organizations will be adopting, is, you know, unless we get to a certain stage where we say we are confident enough, you know, for all the tasks to be done by the machine without all the other stakeholders involved. But I'm still waiting for the day to come. So yeah, here what we have seen is from ideas, it goes into the implementations, the developers working on their local machines, and then triggers the build pipeline. So this is where we say it is the continuous integrations. Artifacts are automatically generated and get pushed to the artifacts bucket. And the later part is where we have the continuous deployment, where, you know, we are continuously deploying into whatever environment that the it is supposed to be deployed at. So one of the things that we have skipped, we wish to show you actually these steps, but when we did the timing, it is just not possible for us to squeeze this part. So earlier I mentioned that we assume that, you know, that feature a feature environment is already created. It's just that the change hasn't been applied to that feature environment, right? So the very first step that, you know, developers have to do when they want this new feature environment is they go to our chatbot, and once they have the artifacts ready for those features, they go to the chatbot and tell the bot that, hey, I want a new feature with this service name and this feature name. So the next step is the bot will actually check, do we have all the prerequisites for this feature? Are the artifacts ready? And then once that check is passing, it will say, okay, I'm ready to bootstrap new EC2 machines, right? This is where the wait time usually comes in. AWS usually takes about 3 to 5 minutes at times to actually get the instance ready before we can do the bootstrapping. So the next part is where the chef bootstrap happens. So we run the bootstrap based on the service role and gets the right artifacts deployed on that machine. And the last part is where the feature routing setup happens. And then after that, what the developers get in the end is a test environment that they can start sharing with the QA and the other stakeholders. Okay, so hopefully if we have a longer time, we could show this. Yep, that's it. So, questions?
How do you take care of any database changes?
For that, actually, that is a question that has been Rajesh wanna address.
Yep. So, most of our
services are using Mongo. So with which obviously schema free, you mean, you know, evolution is not a problem, but the most recent services started using Postgres. So obviously you'll apply all the schema evolution, which is, you know, liquid based or whatever it is, you know, that's something you have to apply for sure. But so far, because we have been using a lot of services on Mongo itself, we didn't actually face much issue in terms of schema evolution.
Just to add on that, usually even if we introduce any feature changes that adds certain fields or whatever, usually we have to make sure that it is backward compatible at least for a certain period of time before it gets phased out, so nothing breaks. Yeah.
I noticed in your HDLC, you have some testing parts. Is this manual testing?
Which one?
QA testing?
No.
QA and user testing.
Okay. This one? So this part, are you referring to this one? This one. So here, for the feature testing, of course, we have always ongoing, you know, automated testing end to end that is run through the scripts and all that, and to make sure that if everything is broken, it gets catch immediately. The other thing is QA usually will have to certify it, make sure that these features satisfy what the business requirement sets the feature up to do.
How long does the testing usually take? Because you said you have 20 to 30 rollouts every day.
Mm-hmm.
How long does this take?
It depends on which business domain you are talking about. So if it's front end, you know, it's much faster. It's like less than 5 minutes. So we have Nightmare.js and also, you know, Selenium based automated testing. You know, you basically use either one of those things. And if it is iOS, it takes a little longer. I don't know if you have heard of this thing called Calabash. So we are using Calabash for testing. So bootstrapping and getting that going, it takes about 10 minutes or more. So you would actually reduce those things, you know, unless it is a major production release. You know, that's basically how we are done.
So this part actually is all automated. That if you look at the build itself, what is happening? Okay. So there is a bunch of tests that was done. So yeah, all these tests starts for this is the unit testing. If you can see, you know, there's a lot of tests going on before it can say, hey, you know, this change is good, nothing is broken, and we can go ahead with the artifacts creation. So if the build that those tests actually fails, we're gonna stop and say we are not gonna proceed with the artifacts creation itself.
So you can quickly go to Travis YML for member service.
Okay. Yeah, so actually we have a lot of mocks here, even in Travis itself. So Mongo, we have and then we have the messaging queue itself, which we are using RabbitMQ, and Redis itself, I think we have options to mock, right? Yeah, but Redis. Okay.
So I heard that you said you have Selenium automated testing, right? So does it increases maintenance overhead somehow, like if the UI changes?
Yeah.
What happens if the automated testing breaks, obviously? So how do you?
Yeah, that's a good point. So the way we are doing it is involve the QA as part of the sprint planning, so they know what is coming and then prepare a bunch ahead of time. But also, because in case of front end, it's all React component based, you can do a lot of local testing on those, unit testing on the components itself. So by integrating that into a bigger piece, that does not really cause much of a problem.
Can you use the microphone?
Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, so that didn't really cause any issues for us. And we also use the same set of scripts to test the production every 15 minutes or so. It basically goes through the entire thing, you know, places, almost it goes all the way till the checkout, and we don't place the order, obviously. But yeah, it does not take much time.
How did you decide that you were mature enough as an organization to do the CI/CD process? Was it from the very beginning, or is it a long run?
That's a very good question. I was talking to Michael about that the other day. So we started our initial CI/CD basically by automating the infrastructure. That was back in 2013. So we just had one developer who knew nothing but Ruby. I said, Chef is all in Ruby, why don't you try that? Let's start that. So, yeah, I mean, we started with you know, a bit of infra automation. That's what was much, you know, required, you know, at that point. That was a need of the hour at that point in time. But slowly, you know, we realized, you know, once we started growing the team, number of services coming in. Back then, we had like about 5 or 6 services. Today, as you saw, it's about 120 odd services. So yeah, we basically started back then and slowly started adding, you know, multiple, you know, features to it. But the one thing which remained is Chef. So we continue to build on top of that. Though we did experiment a bunch of other things, Docker, you know, serverless architectures and all those things. We didn't go there yet. The big thing which we are actually looking at right now is Canary release. Like what Surya just mentioned about, yeah, it's evolution. Yeah, it's not something which happened overnight. But the good thing that has happened right now is that, as most of you know, with microservices, you need a lot of this tooling to basically deploy, you know, as quickly as possible. You have hundreds of services, heterogeneous environments. You have multiple environments, you know, multiple you know, stacks, how do you make sure that everything goes, you know, harmoniously into the production or whatever, you know, setup it is. So that's one of the things I feel has worked out quite nicely for us so far. Yeah, there's still a lot to be done. Yeah, so the question is what happens if two developers are working on the same service on two different features? That does not happen often, but if at all it does happen, you know, both of them will create multiple, you know, setups, you know, both the developers will have a dedicated setup for them, so nothing will actually break because
Surya, can you just go back to the slide?
The which one?
The one which was showing the different environments.
This one?
No, before this. Yeah, this one.
So what happens is, if let's say I basically created a feature branch, you also created the feature branch on the same service. So both of us will basically have this one, yes. Right? So we'll test to our heart's content and make sure that it's working fine, and then only we'll merge to master, right? So typically, I mean, the rule, you know, at least the basic best practice we have is that your master, the changes to the master should not stay there for more than half an hour or whatever it is, right? So if at all you don't follow that, you know, you'll end up having, you know, merge conflicts and all those things, you know, yeah.
As soon as the feature is
yes, yes. As Surya pointed out, this is thick for a reason because you can do a lot of iterations there. Don't do it in the master branch. Because it's in a feature branch, it's up to you to break it as many times as you want and go back. And once you're confident, then only you're merging. So that, you know, we hope that it won't take, you know, long and it won't stay in the master for long. Yeah, that has worked out quite nicely for us. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah. It's true, you need a couple of guys like this. That's one of the things. But besides that, obviously, you know, you don't want to do everything at once, right?
Yes.
So you would take one step at a time. I mean, we started like almost four years ago, and things have evolved. You know, we don't have to probably do so many of these things. You know, there's a lot of open source, you know, tools are also available to do that. And in fact, like what we were telling earlier, we want to actually also, you know, open source some parts of this as well. Especially the parts where releasing semantic versioning and all those things across any kind of, you know, stack, whether it's Go, JavaScript or whatever it is, I feel that has come out quite nicely for us. So that I feel is probably of some use for others in the community as well. Yeah. To going back to your question, yes, I mean, I would just take one step at a time, you know, just have Jenkins or Travis or something.
And I think, and what is important is to get the feature environment ready.
The key thing, yeah. That's what I was. Just next one, please. This is the biggest difference we have in our infrastructure. You know, basically, with microservices, besides all the complexities which you all know, if you were to actually recreate a working environment for every single feature you are building, it's going to be costly, both in terms of time, resources, and also money. Because, you know, you have hundreds of services. Even if you take a subdomain, you have lots of services to create, wire up, you know, there's a lot of time it takes. So this is the best thing that happened to us, you know, in terms of setup, because you're actually reusing everything from here. Let's say in Surya's demo, he changed only one service called member service. So we created only one instance, which means we are paying for only one instance, and it's also setup time is much faster, right? And testing and all those things, deployment, everything worked out much, much faster. So this is one of the salient features, I would say, you know, which probably, you know, we can talk a bit more some other time, or, you know, we should have some blog posts as to how we did it, and also some of the scripts which are there could be potentially open sourced as well.
Can you say when in Redmart's history the feature routing stuff came?
This came in about 2 years ago. 2 years ago, yeah. Yeah, this one, this whole thing. It just came in at a time when we were about to, you know, jump onto microservices. Like, it was exponentially growing. We started with one or two services, and then it just started growing. And it's just about that time we came up with this idea, and it worked out quite nicely for us from timing, resource, costing perspective. Yeah. Yeah, this and some of the other tools, you know, scripts that we have built basically helped take us. The tool basically takes care of which feature, you know, patch and all those things, and also which, like, let's say if we had multiple locations where you want to deploy, whether it's Singapore, Hong Kong, somewhere else, you could actually tell, and it takes care of it for you. One key thing I should tell, it's all on AWS only as of today, but because it's riding on top of Chef, it's pretty easy to, you know, use the, you know, cloud provider for your choice. You know, just change the APIs and it should just work for you. Yeah, that's basically all.
If you can walk through this feature node creation one more time, as I saw one of the slides,
yeah.
There's a Slack chatbot where the developer goes and says that, okay, I need this, I need a new feature node for a new service.
Correct. There's a Slack, this one, right?
And then the chatbot identifies what all artifacts he needs and then creates a EC2 instance. Loads those artifacts there.
Yeah.
And then when the developer is done with the service, whatever development he is doing.
Yeah.
Then is there somewhere in this node creation routine that you are also identifying this node with Chef? Like, okay, when I am deploying this, this is the node that you are going to deploy to, or I'm a little confused there how it identifies that node.
That's based on the Chef, right? Because the entire thing is the Chef, you know, is basically a configuration management tool, right?
So when the chatbot is creating this EC2, is that in this routine only you are mapping the node to the?
Yeah. We are creating a new node based on the repo.
Service name.
Yeah.
Service name that we are creating. Where is the? Yeah. Here. This one. So based on this, we already know what type of instance to be bootstrapped using Chef. And, you know, we also know, you know, where we are supposed to do, because it's a feature environment, and basically create a new instance in this case. Yeah.
And then when I'm doing a merge, then again, I know which node to.
Yeah, oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. So, two distinct things, right? One is when you create a feature environment, we basically create a new instance. That's what Surya was telling, that creation and bootstrapping will take a while. That's why we skip this step. So, you know, barring that, but it's basically similar to what we do for the rest of the environment as well. And in case of existing environment, which is like alpha or, you know, which is pre-production or beta or, you know, this thing, production environment, it's the entire configuration is managed under Chef. So it knows for notification service how many instances am I running and where are all they located, and it basically takes one at a time and upgrade them. Yeah, so you can make it even better by using canary releases, you know, blue green deployments, you know, all those stuff. You know, that's something we are working on right now.
Yeah, I think going back to the Chef, configuration. This is where, you know, the different environment is configured. So in Chef itself, each node is has a tag that says, is it a production instance or beta instance, alpha or feature instance?
And so how do you manage the deletion of the feature
node? It's through Slack as well. We can take a look at it.
So is the developer, when it's finished, he asks for the deletion, or it's...
Yeah, exactly.
So our bot name is called MiniMe. So you can take a look at some of the commands. This, if you see, it's pretty limited because we have the access control to say that certain commands can only be triggered from a certain channel. So in this case, what you're interested is let's say the cleanup feature, right? So the service name that we have is member service, and the feature name is junk demo. Okay, then it will check whether it is allowed to run that command, and it says, yeah, I'm gonna find the node that has this role. As you can see, I think this might explain your questions earlier. So the node name, it's the role itself. One of the way that you can think about doing, which what we have done, is we name the role as a service name plus the feature name at the back. Okay. So now, as you can see, it is already deleting that node, and it is clearing the feature routes. So the developers, that's all they have to do to clean up that feature.
At the end of it, this is basically what we do.
Sorry, you want to run the show status for the feature environments?
Yeah, that's the list for now.
Okay. You can also, let me just check. Okay. We have actually prepared a couple of possibilities for this demo. So, you can take a look at the feature environment status as well, as far as from the front end goes. So for the jug demo, you can see that actually we have prepared quite a number of possibilities before we pick this one. It runs through actually the entire routing pipeline and check. You can see here, this is the API gateway that we have configured. So whatever you see in green is actually the active feature route, which means that if you see this diagram here, means that that endpoint itself is supposed to be a feature route. Means that they should go into the feature instance itself. Okay, whatever is shown in the blue here, it's supposed to go into the that pre-production environment. Okay. Yep. So now the test feature, I mean that instance is completed. Okay, so any other questions? Any other questions, you guys? Anyone? If there's nothing else, I think, okay. Thank you all. Can I get the cable?